For many people, playing video games provides a break from the everyday. Games can take you on incredible adventures from the comfort of your couch, but most importantly, they can bring people together. Thanks for joining us. I'm Destiny Chance. Today, we'll show you heartwarming stories of how gamers turn their virtual talents into real-life impact. Our first story takes you to Boston, where WCVB reporter Erica Tarantel meets a coder who turned his passion into progress.
Zombies on the attack. This is a video game brainstorming session.
That would be funny, actually.
An all-boys coding class is underway at this Dorchester Family Center run by Brookview House, a nonprofit that serves families experiencing homelessness.
We are constantly raising the bar for all of our youth, and our expectation is not only will you hit it, but you're gonna bust right through it.
COO Deborah Collins-Goosby talks about fighting stereotypes, assumptions, and negative messaging with positivity and opportunity.
Access to resources is pivotal.
4 years ago, Brookview started free girls coding classes, then the boys wanted in.
We need more black engineers, more black scientists, more black computer gamers.
It was a happy coincidence when a kids coding nonprofit reached out.
I got an email from KiddoByte, this young man, Robbie, and I was like, it's just always a blessing.
We offer free computer science courses for kids with the goal of sharing our passion for computer science with those who might not have access to it otherwise.
He and a team of volunteers, mostly classmates from Arlington High School, lead weekly sessions for the boys.
Kids have been progressing really, really impressively.
They're certainly enjoying it.
Yeah, that's great. We can absolutely use that.
The learning and that fun, so important.
When you've experienced so trauma, the trauma of homelessness and poverty, sometimes fun is not what you experience sometimes. I want what my kids have and have access to, I want the same things for the kids that come through Brookview.
Such an inspiring initiative. Gaming fun doesn't have to be limited to screens. In Nebraska, a board game designer paves the way for people of color. Here's KETV reporter Waverly Monroe.
Yeah.
Marcus Ross loves board games. He's made a few too, but this one is bigger than the rest.
When you're doing a licensed game, give people the moments that they expect and then a few surprises.
The Lord of the Rings adventure book game will debut in Target.
The 8 chapters take you through the entire Lord of the Rings saga, from Frodo receiving the ring in the Shire all the way to destroying it in Mordor.
He co-designed several chapters.
This one is pretty cool.
It's a cooperative game, which is played like a book.
Breaking up the Fellowship, and then Helm's Deep, and then the finale. So it was actually quite a lot.
A lot of research went into designing his chapters.
There's a difference between watching a movie for fun and then watching a movie for it's going to be work. You need to replicate this for people.
And Ross says despite making 4 games, he doesn't know many black game designers out there.
I will not need all these fingers to count the ones that are notable.
Starla and Mick Fitch love playing games and started with their son.
When we started doing family game night, he was like 4 or 5 years old, and we wanted to introduce him to board games so we could play together.
But they soon ran into the same problem after visiting board game conventions as a family.
We go in there with us and our son, there'll be no kids, there'll be people of color, and very few women.
They wanted to expose more people of color to the expansive world of board games, so they started Our Family Plays Games.
I think if we knew there were more games out there than just Monopoly, we would play more often. Mm-hmm. And it's just a joy, it's a stress reliever,
yes.
And we as people of color, we have enough stresses in the world that if we can find more things that are simple and give us joy and happiness, I think we need to do it.
Starla and Mick host Marcus on their YouTube channel. It's called OFPG Voices. They say it gives gamers of color a platform.
We have a separate show called OFPG Voices where we bring in other underrepresented voices, designers, content creators, artists. They come in and talk about their experiences in the hobby and games they like to play.
For Marcus, he says anyone looking to get into designing should.
Anybody can do this. It just takes a dedication to learning how games are made and learning how to integrate things new people would expect.
Marcus is truly impressive. Up next, an Iowa college student was crowned a Mario Kart champion and found family along the way. Here's KCCI reporter Marcus McIntosh.
We're at Marshalltown Community College inside the esports arena, where we sit down with National Junior College Athletic Association of Esports national champion Amber Lawthers and challenge her to the game she dominates with a little help from Luigi.
Well, I just crossed the finish line. Didn't I win?
But you got two more laps.
Amber Lawthers has been playing Mario Kart for years. Despite a few tips, I was still no match for her in the game in which she has proven to be the best of the best.
Okay, how come I'm not going? Oh, okay.
You could get a perfect start boost if you time it correctly.
At the beginning of the school year, she saw an advertisement and walked into the esports arena and onto the newly formed esports program at Marshalltown Community College.
They just asked me, like, what games do you play?
The esports coaches watched her play Mario Kart, and they knew.
Amber is really something special.
The college sophomore is successful with a controller in her hands because she is truly a student of the game.
Amber comes in at least 2 hours early. She scouts her opponents. She practices like crazy. You know, everything that you would think about a champion doing in traditional sports.
Amber is humbled by but proud of her national championship. She is just as proud of how well she fits in as the only female member of the esports team.
It's probably here in this esports program is the first time that, like, in my life that I can remember where I truly felt accepted as a gamer.
Amber is hoping her success is an example to others. No matter how they look or are perceived, there is a place for everyone in esports.
Well, I've proven that no matter, like, how you identify, you can just come in and become a national champion.
Amber, proving games are rated E for everyone. Stay tuned. After the break, we give you an inside look at the different worlds of gamers. Welcome back. We're now bringing you stories about how games can expose people to different worlds. First, in Kansas City, Missouri, KMBC reporter Alan Shope meets a man who loves his town so much, he built a virtual replica.
It's a rainy, soggy kind of day in Kansas City. But not in this Kansas City.
Possibilities are endless.
And for Overland Park's Travis Hicks, that means Kansas City is endless. Hicks becoming very popular for his version of KC in the Minecraft world.
I've always had a fascination for architecture and living in Kansas City.
Travis putting both of those together. He uses Google Maps to look at buildings and then builds them to scale inside his Minecraft Kansas City. The idea.
Recognizing all these beautiful buildings.
A lot of his videos have already gone viral due to the detail, like his Union Station.
I like how they have the link system.
Travis has been working on the city for 9 months and says it can take up to a full day just to build one building. He says right now he's got about 60 to 70% of the downtown area done, but he hopes to expand.
Eventually I'm going to get to the plaza area.
You can even build little characters like me and go for a walk in the city and into buildings like Union Station.
You can basically walk through different rooms.
For Travis, it's more than just a game.
It's like artwork.
And as for the entire city, well, it's on his mind.
That's gonna take a while.
A truly impressive world he's created. In New Hampshire, fans of Donkey Kong brought their favorite video game to the streets of Concord. WMUR reporter Troy Lynch has the story.
With a vision, some spray paint, and a lift, Manny Ramirez, Cecilia Ulibarri, and Christian Ramirez are able to bring basic brick to life.
Behind us is a Donkey Kong inspired mural.
What was once a normal elevator shaft, now a giant screen playing the original Donkey Kong for everyone to enjoy. Once Manny and Cecilia were pitched the idea, they were game.
We were psyched.
We were so excited. We were ready for it. It was one of the most anticipated murals that we were going to be doing all summer long.
Yeah, and I'm a huge gamer, so to me it was just natural.
So we really wanted to give Concord this fun Easter egg to bring people to the Pleasant Street area.
But why retro Donkey Kong? Apparently it was the two owners of the building's idea.
They were back here during the renovation of this project and looked at it and really thought that the architecture reminded them of Donkey Kong.
Looking for someone who could get their building to a new high score, Elm Grove Companies found positive street art after a quick Google search.
We're so excited about it. And and people that have come by to see it are also so excited.
Now I'm still trying to beat Donkey Kong myself, but positive street art is always looking for new ways to level up New Hampshire. And with this five-story project, believe it or not, it only took them a little over 2 weeks.
You look at this and you can't believe that it just took them, you know, a few weeks to do. I mean, this looks like it took them months.
We want to beautify communities and bring communities together through the works that we do.
The mural has truly brought lots of smiles to people walking by. Up next, we take you to the world of pinball fandom in Louisville, Kentucky. WLKY reporter Addie Miners visits an annual event that unites pinball fans from all generations.
From pinball to Pac-Man to an interactive Mario Kart, gamers at the Louisville Arcade Expo tell me it's like 40,000 square feet of nostalgia.
Where I grew up, that was what we did when we were kids, so I mean, this is great because it kind of brings back childhood for me.
Oh, this is a highlight of the year.
Around 5,000 people flock to the expo every year. Featured games include 200 different pinball machines, plus another 150 video games, ranging from the early 80s to now.
We love it. I mean, we come every year. It's a great, you know, a great fun, lots of pinball action.
There's like a magic to this era of gaming that it's hard to replicate.
So many don't try to. Instead, they preserve it. Tony Lucio and his daughter Beverly restored this classic pinball machine and modeled it after a former Lexington restaurant, the Parquette Drive-In.
We obtained a new play field. We added all kinds of custom touches to it on the sides and throughout the play field. We made the drop targets look like the actual sign.
Some of the machines come from manufacturers, but most of them come from collectors like the Lucios.
It's an awesome experience. It's family friendly. Everybody loves it.
And a family friendly environment is what organizers say is the goal.
A lot of what we like is celebrating that with the newer, younger generation. So parents can come and show their kids like, hey, you may beat me at the newest Halo, but I can destroy you on this Atari.
The love of the game, bringing people together. Stay tuned. After the break, we'll bring you stories of gamers using their skills to change lives. Welcome back. We're now introducing you to people who are gaming for good. In Maryland, WBAL-TV reporter Theo Hayes has the story.
Oh my God, that's a PB.
18-year-old Theo Lazarou is like a lot of teenagers. He loves to play video games.
Yes. Just PB'd 64.
But instead of just racking up points and making it to the next level, this Howard County teen is raising money for Johns Hopkins Pediatric Leukemia Research.
I think people are starting to realize that they can take their passion and put it towards helping out their community.
Here we go.
I saw people playing video games, which is something that I really like to do, and I saw that they were making a difference in their community. So to me, it seemed like a no-brainer that I would want to do the same.
Theo played for 24 hours straight.
Even for people who love video games, doing it for 24 hours can be extremely difficult, but thankfully I had a lot of support from family and friends.
He started a fundraiser on Twitch, a popular live streaming platform, and now, thanks to his 1,000 followers, he has raised over $700.
Johns Hopkins Children's Center is near and dear to my heart. I was actually born at Johns Hopkins, and I've seen many kids' lives taken from them early. Because of leukemia, and anything that I can do to stop that, I'll be on board with it.
We met the donation!
A gamer using his passion for a purpose.
Theo is changing lives one game at a time. Up next, a Mississippi school is using state-of-the-art technology to teach. Here's WAPT reporter Madeline Nolan with the story.
From the blackboard to digital classrooms, technology is leading the charge in the way we both learn and teach. This is done through virtual reality.
Come here. You're not gonna escape.
VR can allow students to visit places they may not have the chance to visit, whether that be historical landmarks like Jamestown or speaking to civil rights leaders as they tell their stories.
The way that the technology works, it makes you have a sense of presence. And that sense of presence is where the biggest impact comes.
This will definitely enhance our students' learning, allowing them to bring their dreams and their imaginations to fruition and just run with the ideas.
Jackson Public Schools is taking advantage of virtual reality. Some 19,000 students will soon have access to the metaverse from the classroom. It's something that scholars are excited about. With VR headsets, students will be able to be completely immersed into an experience without leaving the classroom.
Across a wide variety of subjects.
Then they could actually go into the cell and touch some of those organelles inside the cell and learn about them.
All of this is done in partnership with a local company named Labaki. It develops VR solutions for education. As a former educator, the CEO of Labaki, Amber Kerr, wants to change the educational system in the U.S.
Yeah, it's really funny. You know, whenever we talk about VR and what the possibilities are, and I start talking, people are like, yeah, sure, you can do all of that. And then you put a headset on and they're like, oh, no, you really can.
The educational curriculum developed by Labaki covers all subjects and caters to different types of learning styles, from hands-on learning to visual or auditory.
We'll be able to assess within the experiences what step the student needs to take. So, okay, I can assess they're struggling here. Now let's make the experience go this way. That's individualized education. And that's possible, and that's the next iteration of what this is gonna do.
Kerr says there's also been great results with students on the autism spectrum.
It makes them feel very empowered. Students, we've seen nonverbal students put a headset on and lead missions.
JPS scholars are also becoming career focused.
One of our students is interested in being a NASA engineer, and he can go into those NASA space stations and actually experience what he would be doing as a NASA engineer.
Up next, people gather for the love of anime and gaming. Every year, South Portland, Maine hosts PortCon, an event celebrating the culture.
Everyone is just a diehard fan of something, and it's a really cool community because everyone loves to support and lift up each other.
PortCon is a place where people can take a break from their daily lives and step into a world of creativity and kindness.
I just love that people come to these things with such a positive mindset. It's kind of an escapism for them.
Being creative is very important to me, and I think it should be important to anybody that wants to be able to push themselves beyond their humdrum day-to-day thing.
People feel that sort of connectedness here that I think that they've been missing in the last few years.
It's an event where cosplayers, anime fans, and gamers come together to bond over their shared passions.
It's a place where we can just be ourselves and celebrate and have fun and really just be happy for the weekend about the things that we love.
What a wonderful way to celebrate the love of gaming. And last but not least, in Mississippi, WAPT reporter Cecil Hannibal meets a woman using her gaming platform for social justice.
One woman is fighting for change in the most unexpected way.
It doesn't matter if I beat all the games, then it would be all she does is achieve in life.
Meet Natasha Zinda, a mother of three and a full-time content creator. She's gained over 10,000 followers on Twitch under the name Zombie Kills. Twitch, the popular live streaming platform, is known for gaming, but she says it's becoming much more.
It is a great and wonderful place. I equate it to like the wave when people started having televisions and how much more information we were able to share and gather with each other. We have talk shows. We have everything. Twitch is the new wave.
From inside her Clinton home, she broadcasts to thousands of people each week, drawing in fans with her live gameplay and what she calls chaotic energy. Zinda uses her channel to address a lack of inclusion and representation in the gaming community, a space dominated by white men.
Actively working against the system of privilege and actively dismantling white supremacy. And seeing that done in an animation space gives me a lot of hope for what can be done in the game space.
She discusses social issues like prison reform and even uses her platform to fundraise. She's encouraged her followers to donate nearly $80,000 for various causes.
Every dollar feeds 10 kids. So we've raised 16, 40, So that's 16,400 kids that just got meals through No Kid Hungry.
And her influence is being felt here in the metro.
I've known Natasha since high school. I was the quiet kid that drew, and I always had my headphones on, and Natasha was a little bit more louder than me.
Philip Rollins is the owner of Offbeat, the only Black-owned comic book and record store in Jackson.
I've been in comic book stores where I've been uncomfortable and been followed around. I've been in record stores that same way, and I've been stereotyped.
Rollins says he opened the store as a safe space for Black creatives and sci-fi fans. COVID-19 devastated many small businesses. In the early months of the pandemic, Rollins' store hit a slow period, and Zenda hosted an online fundraiser to help him through it.
These kind of things are life-changing. We don't have to be in the streets. We don't have to be outside and interacting with other people to be changing and doing good in the world. We can be doing good right from home.
But her work comes at a cost.
Being Black and being a woman in these spaces isn't always the easiest. As a matter of fact, it's very gatekept and it's very exclusionary.
Zenda says she receives vulgar and racist comments all the time and has even received death threats. But the opportunity to create a safer space for people of color in the gaming community motivates her to endure the hate.
I'm too blessed to be stressed, I guess, as they like to say, right? That's what they say. I really just don't care because I'm doing the right thing. And at the end of the day, I'm gonna sleep really well knowing that I'm doing the right thing every day.
Zenda's message, the fight for change can take many forms, whether it's at home playing a video game or at the register of a comic book store. Representation matters.
We hope these stories showed you all the good that can come from the gaming world. I'm Destiny Chance. From all of us at Stitch, thank you for watching. See you next time.